We're here to worship God, the God who was revealed to us in Jesus and the God who has sent his Holy Spirit to us so the life of God might flow from us. And I guess on this day, I should say, Happy New Year. Welcome to the year 2022, a new year that God has opened up for us and a new opportunity that we are going to have this year to continue to follow the path that God has for us. As we gather together for the first Sunday of this new year, let's hear the words of Psalm chapter 18. I love the Lord. You are my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my savior. My God is my rock in whom I find protection. He is my shield, the power that saves me, and my place of safety. I called on the Lord who is worthy of praise, and he saved me from my enemies. Welcome to the Canterbury Baptist Church online service. This is actually going to be the only service that Canterbury Baptist Church will be holding this particular Sunday. The live service is not going to be taking place. I think most of our congregation, if not all of our congregation, is currently away on holidays. I think after a year or a couple of years of lockdown, many people are very keen to be able to get away, visit family, and just experience some new horizons for a little while. So if this is you, if you're out and about, then blessings on you, and we'd continue to pray for safety for your travels. But it is a joy that we are able to come back together, and we are able to gather even through this online format. So wherever you are, whatever day or time you may be watching, and however you are enjoying this Christmas and New Year holiday season, we do continue just to pray God's abundant blessing upon you. Now, I'm not going to be preaching today. It's my great joy to introduce to you Graeme Semple. Graeme Semple is one of the regional pastors, if you will. He's the pastor of the pastors. And in Graeme's particular case, he's my pastor. So he's the one who regularly gets in touch with me and just makes sure that I'm tracking along okay. And so I really appreciate his ministry to me, and I guess his ministry through me into the life of Canterbury Baptist Church. It's a great joy that I can welcome him in to be our preacher for today. His text, which will be our reading for today, is Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, rejoice. Let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Keep putting into practice all you learned and received from me, everything you heard from me and saw me doing. Then the God of peace will be with you. May the Lord bless the reading of His word, and let's hear from Graeme Semple as he reflects with us on this word.
Good morning, church, and welcome to online ministry. My name is Graeme Semple, and I'm the regional pastor for the west of Victoria with the Baptist Union of Victoria. My role is specifically to look after and care and nurture pastors in their ministry, and to have the opportunity of being a first contact to local churches. And so this morning, it's a joy for me to come and open up God's Word to you. One of the thrills I have of being able to share and open up God's Word so that people are being renewed and refreshed and focused on what God has to say. And this morning, we've got a message called Guiding Instructions in Uncertain Times. And as you're very much aware, with all that's going on in our world and what's going on in our times here in Australia, this is a word that is very relevant and necessary to hear. And so my prayer is that as you receive this word, you'll be able to implement the word into your own life. And so may God bless you as you receive this word today. The aspect of understanding what God's word is saying comes as the process of living confidently in uncertain times is by following God's guiding instructions. Today and these past 20 months have been very, very unsettling. They've been disruptive, particularly here in Victoria and now in New South Wales, to all our lives, our businesses, to our education, our recreation, our sport, our churches, and our families. It has created much stress and tension and anxiety right across. And as you're probably aware of what's going on right across our world with the climate change that's going on, that's impacting the hottest month on record, what's going on in Afghanistan and the terrible issues that are happening there and in other places, but particularly in light of COVID, it is impacting people across our world. Although there is a vaccine, there is still uncertainty. There is no 100% guarantee. And there are conspiracy theories. There are concerns. There are uncertainties. Life is not what it used to be, And neither will it ever be returning to what we've known it to be before. We have to learn to live with uncertainty, and yet at the same time, live with a sense of confidence. And so we are needing to learn to understand what that confidence is in. Firstly, we need to have a confidence that God is in control, even though we don't see it. We also need to learn to have a confidence that God knows what is going on and that He cares, even though I don't feel it. And we need to learn to live with confidence that God is working all things out for our good and for His glory. This is our hope. If we lose this confidence, we lose everything. And so I don't know where your confidence is this morning, but I'm wanting to refocus you, redirect you to the point that your focus is on God. Your focus in that God is knowing what is going on, and He cares for you, and that He's working all things out for His good and for His glory. But we also need to live with a sense of being focused. We get distracted when uncertain things happening with the COVID situation and with situations that are happening within our families, within our organizations, within our business. We get distracted. And so we need to learn to live with a sense of being focused. First of all, we need to have a focus on Jesus, the author and the perfecter of our faith in Hebrews 12, verse 2. Often when uncertain times come, we lose our focus of who we're meant to be focusing on. Secondly, we need to be focused on the mission that Jesus actually gave to us, which is go and make disciples. When uncertain times come and when situations arrive and uncertainty arrives, how often do we lose focus from that which Jesus actually told us to focus in on? Making disciples. We get so more concerned about the issues and the situations and the circumstances that we lose our focus. And thirdly, we need to have a sense of focus, that ultimate goal, that God is restoring everything to Himself. In Revelation 21, where there is a vision that John saw, that everything was going to be new, a new heaven, a new earth. No more tears, no more sadness, no more night. Everything is going to be as it should have been, as God intended it in the very beginning. This is our hope. And so we need to be remaining focused. As disciples of Jesus, our role model is to live a different life from the rest of the world and to help others live a different life in uncertain times. For this to happen, we have to experience this for ourselves. And I believe that the Apostle Paul provides six clear instructions for us to follow. And these instructions are seen in Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 to 9. And there are six clear instructions that I want to share with you. But to bring it into context, let's read what Paul wrote to the church at Philippi. Beginning in verse 4 in chapter 4, he says these things. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again. Rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guide your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me, or seen in me, put it in practice, and the God of peace will be with you. And so in this passage of Scripture, we see six clear guiding instructions for us to follow in uncertain times. And the first one is to rejoice. He says, rejoice in the Lord. It doesn't say rejoice in your situation or your circumstances, because situations and circumstances can be overwhelming. And so we need to have a sense of focusing in on God, that somehow God is doing something bigger and better than we can understand and appreciate. And the Apostle Paul understood these things. He actually implemented these six instructions himself. But where was he when he was writing this and corresponding to the church? He was actually in prison in Rome. The year is AD 63. Emperor Nero is the Caesar at this time. The church is undergoing persecution. There's a lot of uncertainty. So in writing to the Philippians, he provides clear instructions. In fact, in a verse of scripture that is a little later on from the passage I just read, he says this, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether in plenty or in want. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. His joy was in the Lord. Not in his situation, not in his circumstances, but a confidence that he could rejoice in the Lord. In fact, he says it again. He says, again I say, rejoice. The aspect of joy. In the Old Testament, we see Nehemiah speaking to the children of Israel as they had been rebuilding the walls and restructuring everything. There was a sadness that had come and overwhelmed them. But in the midst of this sadness, he says, this is not a time for sadness. This is a time to be joyful, because the joy of the Lord is your strength. There's something about joy that provides nourishment, that provides confidence, that provides strength. I wonder, have you lost your strength? And you're needing that strength to be renewed. Well, it begins by rejoicing. In fact, the writer to Proverbs in chapter 17, verse 22 says it like this, a merry heart does good like a medicine. There is something about a joyful spirit that resonates with people. I wonder, have you taken your medicine? The medicine of being joyful in the Lord in spite of your situation, in spite of your circumstances. Again, we see Paul lived out this, and he, as he was corresponding with the church at Philippi, he probably was reflecting upon something that happened when he was in Philippi the first time. You see, in that first time, he actually had been arrested, he had been whipped, he had been thrown into prison with Silas, and as he's in the prison, he begins to pray and he begins to rejoice in the Lord. An earthquake comes, and as a result of the earthquake, the Philippian jailer, who's about to kill himself, Paul stops. And God brings about salvation into that prison as a result of the situation and the circumstances. So that Paul was trusting in God in the midst of his situation and not trusting in the circumstances. God was doing something beyond our understanding. Therefore, we can rejoice in him, that even in this, God is going to use it for his glory. It's a choice. Will you make that choice of taking this guidance? Well, secondly, we see there needs to be a response. We need to respond graciously. Paul puts it like this, let your gentleness be evident to all. Have you noticed when situations and circumstances are outside of your control, how we become reactionaries to them and not responders to them? We need to be able to learn how to respond in spite of the situation that wants to control our lives, wants to control our situation. We need to learn to be responders in these situations. Jesus himself says it like this: in the same way, let your light shine before people that they may see your good works and glorify God. When Paul, who had been arrested, his natural response was positive, so that others were drawn to something in him. You see, even Jesus modeled these kind of responses. Jesus lived out these guiding instructions. We know that he lived it out by rejoicing in the Lord, in God. For in Hebrews it actually says, for the joy that set before him, he endured the cross. He could see beyond the situation of the cross, and so he rejoiced in spite of the situation. In his response, his first response as he was nailed to the tree was, Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. The element of responding graciously in the situation has resonated from the cross through generation after generation after generation, that we see something different in the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ, that we too have embraced the reality of what his response was to the cross, and therefore we can apply that same response in our situation and our circumstances, trusting that even this God will use for his glory. Are you a responder or are you a reactor? Do you respond to the situations in such a way that people are drawn to the person of Jesus inside of you? Or do they see that same spirit of anger, resentment, vengeance? By responding graciously, people are drawn to something that is inside of you, the Spirit of God. My prayer is that we will learn to be responders and not reactioners. Well, thirdly, we see that his instruction is to remain calm. He puts it in these words in verse 6. He says, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, with prayer and petition. He said, do not be anxious. In situations that are outside of our control, we naturally become fearful. We naturally become anxious, uncertain about what's going to be happening. The greatest example of this is where Jesus, after preaching and teaching and speaking to the disciples and a whole group of other people, decided to get in a boat and go to the other side. He instructs them, let's go to the other side. After a full day of ministry, of course, he's tired. So he goes to sleep on a cushion. It was recorded in Mark's gospel. And while they were on their way across to the other side, a storm swells up. The waves come. The winds come. And in Mark's gospel, it's recorded that they began to panic. They began to be fearful, so much so that they actually come and they wake Jesus. And immediately their response to him was, don't you care that we are about to drown? Jesus' response in the midst of this is not to say anything directly to them, first of all, but to respond to the wind and the waves. Speaks to them. Calm down. Be still. And immediately, the response of the wind and the waves is to die down, and everything is calm. And we see in Mark's gospel is that they were even more afraid when everything becomes calm, because they ultimately wanted Jesus to do something different than what they were anticipating his ultimate response was. He remains calm, and in the calmness, he speaks peace into the situation. And he brings peace into the situation and the circumstances that are surrounding him at that time. And that's what he wants us to learn, that he ultimately is in control, that we can trust him, that he hasn't abandoned us, he hasn't rejected us. We may feel that he has, but the reality is that he hasn't. He's teaching us something in the midst of this. And in the midst of COVID, he's actually teaching us something that we may not have actually gleaned yet. He is in control. He's working through all of this situation, and he wants us to trust him, to rely on him, to remain calm and not be panicking or fearful. So let the calmness of Jesus, let the shalom of God come into your life as you speak, as you live, as you operate, in spite of the situations and circumstances that each one of us are facing. We need a sense of calm. Well, the fourth instruction is to rely on the Lord. It says in everything, present your requests to God, casting all your anxieties upon him because he cares for you. We need to be trusting God with all our heart and all our understanding, as it talks about in Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6. A verse that was given to me by my dad as I entered into life as an adult. He says, Graeme, always remember Proverbs 3, 5 and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your paths. We need to be holding on to the promises of God in the midst of our situations. Our situations that we're facing, our circumstances that we're facing, are a major distraction. They're distracting us from focusing on what God has called us to focus on, which is him. And he gives to us promises that in the midst of them, we can rely on him and his promises. For me, a song that was given to me was very, very powerful when I was going through what I call a dark night of the soul, when I was questioning a lot of things. And the song just goes like this: God's promises are rainbows in the night, shining hope inside when shadows cloud your eyes. God's promises are rainbows in the night, guiding through the darkest times. And so for you, as you go through whatever your situation, whether it's related to COVID, whether it's related to sickness, whether it's related to family issues or other matters or business, keep focused on the Lord. Keep relying on him. Keep holding on to his promises, because God is faithful. He can't deny himself. God is true and God is good in spite of all the situations and circumstances that we're facing. When God was speaking to Joshua as they were about to go into the promised land, he says, "Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified or discouraged by the situations that you're going to face. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go." God is not going to abandon you in the midst of this situation, in the midst of your issues. God is right there with you, guiding you, helping you in the midst of whatever situation and circumstances that you're facing on. Are you relying on God, or are you relying on your own insight, in your own understanding? Well, Paul's instructions are very, very clear. Bring your petitions with thanksgiving, with an anticipation that the answer is on its way. You will receive. And not only will you receive, as you bring your petitions, there is a great exchange that takes place. He says, "And do not be anxious about anything, but with everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God transcends all understanding will guard your heart and your minds in Christ Jesus." The very place that the battle is going on is in your mind and in your heart, your emotions, your feelings, your thinking. And God speaks peace into your situation, into your life, so that whether you're going through the fire or through the flood, you have the confidence that God is with you. And you have his peace that passes all understanding, that will guard your heart and your mind. Well, the fifth instruction is to be able to recall the positive. Paul puts it beautifully like this. And he says, "Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, Whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. When uncertain times come, our minds get distracted, and we ultimately begin to think negative thoughts. When people have said certain things about us or said certain things to us that have pierced us, that may have triggered memories, we naturally go back to recalling the negative. But Paul's instruction to us is that whatever situation is you're going through, to be able to recall the positive. I love how Jeremiah in Lamentations chapter 3 puts this. He says, I remember my affliction and my wanderings, the bitterness and the gall. I remember them well, and my soul is downcast within me. And maybe that's how you're feeling this morning. Maybe that's where you're at, just like the prophet Jeremiah. But that's not where it ends. He goes, yet in spite of all of this, in spite of how I'm feeling, I call this to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Jeremiah was being very real. He was being very honest. He was being very reflective about how he was feeling in the midst of his situation. He felt his affliction and his wandering and the bitterness that was welling up. And he recalls them. And his soul is downcast. This is how he's personally feeling. He's feeling great depression. Yet in the midst of this depression that he was experiencing, he calls something to mind. The positive. The what's true. The what's noble. The what's right. His emotions and feelings are real. But they're not necessarily true to what God's word says. And so he's then fighting the emotional element and taking hold of the things that are right and true and good and honorable and pure. And in the midst of this, we see that he experiences a different attitude. It's a choice to be true, to be right, and to, in spite of our situations and our circumstances, to be able to recall the right things, the good things, the things that God has said, God's promises. What comes to mind for you when you face difficult situations and circumstances? Do you become so consumed by the circumstances themselves and the negative issues? Or in the midst of this, are you holding on to God's mercy and God's faithfulness, which is new every morning? It's fresh. It's fresh manna. And that's what God wants to give to us today. Finally, we see his final instruction is reproduce what you have learned. He says it like this: whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice, and the God of peace will be with you. Another way he says this is in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. He says, follow my example as I follow Christ's. Are you applying God's word to your life? You do your devotions every day. Most of us do. Are you allowing God's word to penetrate into your life that you actually carry out the instructions that is actually given in his word? And some of those instructions are not easy. Pray for those who persecute you. If someone slaps you on this one cheek, offer the other side. The aspect of offering forgiveness, forgive as Christ has forgiven you. These are not easy. In fact, I find them almost impossible. And that's why we need the grace of God to be applied into our lives that we carry out, not in our own strength. In fact, the Apostle Paul, one time, he pleaded with God, take this situation away from me. Yet not my will, your will be done. That's what Jesus also cried when he was facing the cross. He says, I don't want to go to the cross, but yet I'm going to trust you. I'm going to hold on to you. And that's what Paul did too. And Paul, God's response to Paul at that particular point of time, my grace is sufficient. And so he took hold of the grace and he applied the grace into his life and he lived out the grace of God that was implemented into his life. And so God's grace is always sufficient for each and every one of us. And therefore, we need to hold on to. We need to rely on completely. And we need to reproduce what we've learned and apply it to our lives. Not just when things are going right and good, but when things are going not so good, when situations are outside of our control, still applying God's word and living out God's word in our lives every day. Because through it all, we will be living our lives above our situations and circumstances, that others will see how we're coping and will be drawn to the person and work of Jesus who lives inside of you. Are you reproducing what you have learned? Well, the process of living confidently in these uncertain times is to be like Paul, is to follow God's guiding instructions. Rejoicing in the Lord, always. Responding graciously. Remaining calm. Relying completely on the Lord. Recalling the positive. And reproducing what you have learned in your life. My prayer for you today is that you will be able to live out these instructions. And that by living them out, you live above your circumstances. And by living above your circumstances, others will be drawn to Jesus because of your powerful testimony in what God is able to do. May God bless you. Let me pray. Lord, we want to thank you that you understand what it means to go through situations and circumstances that are outside of control. When issues come, as they do to each and every one of us. But we thank you that you lived out those by following the instructions and living according to the word of God. Lord, each one of us are going through difficult situations and circumstances. Help us to live above them, that a confidence is that you're in control, that you do care and you know what's going on. Confidence that ultimately, God, you're working all things out for good and for your glory. We want to turn our eyes upon you. We want to remain focused on the mission you've given us and the ultimate goal. But help us now, oh God, and particularly those of us who are listening online, draw near as they cast their burden on you. May they know you love them and care for them. Minister your grace to them, that they will be able to carry out the instructions that you give and receive a peace that passes all understanding. Bless them. Bless them now in abundance, Lord, that others will be drawn to you through their life and testimony in these trying times. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Imagine.
And it's great that we can gather together to pray and to reflect together. So let's join together and pray. Dear God, thank you that we are able to enjoy this moment, that we're able to gather together in this new year. And even though we're not meeting live this particular Sunday, that nonetheless we can still join together through this online service and we can worship you and lift our hearts to you. Thank you, Lord, that we're able to gather together in this way. I'm going to just leave a moment here and I'm going to ask you just to offer a word of praise on anything, any topic you'd like, but just what is your heart of praise to God right now? Graeme Semple's sermon got us thinking through the topic of what it means to live faithfully even in the face of uncertain, challenging times. And certainly over the last couple of years through COVID, we have faced uncertain and challenging times. And even 2022, we can see that there are conditions there that will likely make 2022 also a year in which we will be facing challenging and some uncertain times as well. I'm going to ask you just to take a moment. What is it that you heard from Graeme Semple's sermon that spoke to you? Was there a sense of God just drawing something to your attention out of what he shared today? Just spend some time reflecting on that. Now I'm going to ask you just to take a moment just to think forward to the year 2022. What is it that you'd like to pray for about this year ahead? Of course, there's much uncertainty and there are many things that we don't know about the year that lies ahead. But nonetheless, what is it about this coming year that you would like to actually lift up in prayer? It could be a personal thing. Maybe you're aware of some personal challenges or maybe even some personal opportunities, some good opportunities that you're anticipating in this year ahead and you want to just thank God for them. But also maybe you're aware of some challenging times that you're anticipating, maybe in your family or maybe just in our society or in our church or in different contexts. I really just want to open this space up for you to take a moment just to commit the year 2022 to the Lord in your own way and in a way that connects to the things that sit heavily upon your heart. So let's pray for 2022 now. Lord God, thank you for this moment we've been able to join together in prayer. Lord God, we do lift up those people who are currently on holidays or currently traveling. We do ask that you would keep each of us safe in all of our travels. Lord God, we are also mindful of those who are struggling with ill health or other challenging conditions at the moment. And we do ask, Lord God, that you would be gracious to them, that they would have a wonderful sense of your presence with them, even through the more difficult and challenging moments that they are going through right now. But Lord God, I do want to thank you that we can enter into this new year with hope, that whatever may be on the horizon, whatever unexpected things may come up, we know with utter conviction that you are with us each and every step of the way. And Lord God, it is with that faith and that confidence that we step into this new year, looking forward to where it is that you will lead us. Lord God, we commit all of these prayers into your hands in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us in our service for today. Now, just a quick little announcement, a reminder that next Sunday, the 9th of January 2022, we will be regathering in live services. So our live services will recommence on the 9th of January. So if you're around Canterbury at that time, then please feel free to come in and join us then, but also to let you know that the online service will be continuing as well. So if you are on holidays during that time, then please join us through the online service as well. Now, if you'd like to get in touch with me, you can email me here, but just to let you know, I'm going to be on holidays. As a matter of fact, at the time you're watching this video, I am on holidays. Welcome to the wonders of modern technology, recording before I go on holidays. So I'm not necessarily going to be responding to emails until about the 10th of January. But nonetheless, if you'd like to get in touch, there is my email. If you're in a position where you can give towards the work of Canterbury Baptist Church, then the bank account details for Canterbury Baptist are now up on the screen. But as always, if you're not in a position to do that, then please receive this service as our gift to you. Now, as we stand here at the beginning of a new year, and as each one of us, or many of us, are on holidays or enjoying some time away from our ordinary work, I pray that this season would be a time of refreshment for each of us. That in a new way we would reconnect with family, we would reconnect with friends, we would reconnect with loved ones, would even reconnect with a sense of ourself and a sense of God with us. But all in anticipation of the year that is ahead of us. So let us enjoy the season that we get to be in right now. And let us continue to celebrate all that God has given to us. And then let's look forward to regathering together and walking the path through 2022 as God leads us. As we enjoy this moment, this season in our life at the moment, let us each go into this week. Let us go in peace.